Welcome everybody to a new episode of Flower Circus Talks. I think we had some technical difficulties, so hopefully we're back now. This time, episode number 96 already. Today, a very special episode. We're going to talk about chrysanthemums, and not just chrysanthemums. We're going to talk with the biggest breeder of chrysanthemums in the world, Deliflor Chrysanthemum. And we have the director of Deliflor Chrysanthemum, Peter Zaatin. So let's quickly invite him into the live stream, because I've got one big question for him. I worked for Deliflor Chrysanthemum, and after that I started Flower Circus, but there are a lot of people working there already for almost their whole life, like Peter as well. So I want to know what the secret is of all that. So let's quickly get him into the live stream.
Hi, Joe.
Peter, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me and inviting me.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great honor. I know you don't do a lot of interviews, but that you make some time and to come into the Flower Circus Talks. So I'm honored that you're here.
Very welcome.
So first of all, what's the secret? I mean, if I'm correct, after you left college, you started at Deliflor and you're still there. But you're not the only one at Deliflor.
No, actually, quite a lot of people work here for quite some time now. For me, myself, 32 years already.
Wow.
Well, what's the secret? I think people need challenges every day.
Yeah.
Working at Deliflor, there were always challenges. We always had, new things to discover, new things to develop, new things to do. And that is one important thing, I think. Besides that, Deliflor is part of the Bakercam Group, a family-run business. And for me personally, family-run business, it gives stability, continuity. That is important for me personally, but also for quite some other people here in the company. And another thing is, inside of Deliflor, people respect each other. People trust each other, and we work together. We help each other. We help each other to solve problems which might occur.
Yeah.
So it's one family.
It really is, but it became a worldwide family because you've got offices and locations all over the world.
Yeah, we have got two production facilities in Africa, in East Africa, one in Uganda and in Ethiopia, where we are producing our cuttings. And we are planning to start a new production facility in Kenya as well next year, or maybe, I guess, next year.
Yeah.
And next to that, we have got sales offices in Japan and Colombia. And at that locations, we are doing some breeding and doing a lot of trialing as well. So, basically, we are covering the world with these three locations.
Okay. And why, let's start with the beginning. Why are you in Africa? It's for the young plants, but why did you choose Africa?
Well, mainly because of the climate and the quality we can produce there. So another thing is we can year-round produce almost the same amount volume of cuttings.
Yeah.
And that is also what we need here in Holland. And if we used to produce in Europe or in Holland in the past, but then in wintertime, we didn't produce the amount of cuttings we needed and not of the quality which is desired by our clients.
Okay. Yeah, because the 8th of March, obviously there are more big flower holidays, but the 8th of March is one of the biggest, I think, in chrysanthemums. Then you need the right quality of cuttings in the most difficult part of the year in Holland.
Yeah, correct. John, but in the meantime, one thing, the last three sentences of you, I heard an echo.
Okay, is it gone now?
No.
It's still an echo. Okay, let me reconnect quickly. So hopefully the echo is gone. Just don't do anything, Peter. It's just Flower Circus magic. I will disappear, come back, and then everything's solved. And I'm back again without any echo.
Yeah, terrific.
You see, it's Flower Circus magic. So the producing of codlings is happening in Africa and Uganda, Ethiopia, and Kenya coming up as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And why those three countries or those two countries?
Well, a few things. As a baker camp group, we're producing an awful lot of cuttings. Chrysanthemums only are about 700 million stems or cuttings a year. And for baker camp, we produce also a quite significant volume of cuttings from other products.
Yeah.
And to do it on one farm or in one country brings along risk. And we want to spread our risk. And also for in order to manage farms well, we think units of about 20 hectares or 25 hectares is perfect.
Okay. So it's spreading risks, not only political, but also with the climate changes probably as well.
Yeah, so, correct.
Yeah. And of course, when we go one step back, producing cuttings is one thing, but you're a breeder as well. Yeah. So you make new varieties.
Yeah. And that's our core business.
Yeah. And that's all happening in Holland, or is it also divided or parts in, for example, Colombia, where you have an office, or Japan, or is it all done in Holland?
Well, our mission is bringing beauty to life.
Yeah.
And we want to develop new varieties, which are suitable varieties for every customer and every consumer all around the world, throughout the world.
Okay.
And in order to meet that goal, we think we need to we need several locations where we can trial and breed our varieties, because the circumstances in Holland are very different from the circumstances in Medellin or in Japan. So we need several testing and trial locations.
Yeah.
And we do also do some breeding on location in Japan and Colombia.
Okay, because the climate has such a big influence on how it grows, how a chrysanthemum grows. Did you really need to test it?
If you look at the temperature, for instance, the night temperature, and especially if the night temperature is low, it has a lot of influence on the initiation and development of the flower buds.
Okay.
And below 16 degrees, development of flower buds and initiation of flower buds will go slower. And below 10 or 6 degrees, it will even stop.
Okay.
So depending on the altitude where you're growing, and a lot of chrysanthemums are grown on higher altitude, not every variety will be suitable for that circumstances.
Okay. So let's say the biggest variety of Deliflor in Holland, or for the customer, is Baltica.
Yep.
So it can be that Baltica isn't a suitable variety, for example, for Japan or Colombia.
Or
that one is doing well everywhere.
technically speaking, for our customers, the growers, Baltica you can grow almost everywhere.
Okay.
But when it goes to customer preferences, not every, for instance, in Japan, Baltica is not particularly popular for them.
Okay. So, and in the breeding process, it's not a matter of keeping varieties. It's a matter of throwing away new varieties. With how many crossings do you start? How many crossings do you make a year?
Well, we make about 500,000 crossing each year.
How many?
500,000.
Yeah.
We produce 500,000 seeds a year.
Yeah.
To be more accurate. And well, the whole process of breeding of a new variety takes about 4-5 years.
Yeah.
And we are happy after 5 years, after throwing away a lot of new varieties or possible varieties, we are satisfied when we introduce about 10 to 20 good varieties each year.
Wow.
So out of the 500,000 unique exemplars, we hope to have about 20 good ones.
Wow, that's unbelievable. And what are the things you are looking for when I mean, you need to test all those new varieties or possible new varieties. Obviously, you need to check how they grow, how they look. But I mean, you probably get from half a million, you get to maybe 5,000. But from that stage, what happens then? Because probably growing, they all look already quite well. Or what are the final stages to make sure it becomes a final introduction?
Well, at first, you mentioned coming back from 500,000 to 5,000. Then you're looking at technical specifications.
Okay.
And when we reduce the amount from 5,000 to, let's say, 100 or 200, then comes along the commercial specifications.
Yeah.
And, well, we have several goals in our breeding. For over the last, well, I think 8 years, one of our most important goals is to develop more sustainable varieties, reliable, yeah, but sustainable. And sustainable for us is developing or introducing tolerance for heat or a cold temperature.
Yeah.
Tolerance for insects, for fungi, and so on. Developing resistance.
Yeah.
Against diseases.
Okay.
But also, our varieties have to be reliable and efficient in their cultivation.
Yeah.
So not too many waste, not much waste. Short response time, so a short cycle.
Yeah.
Reducing the amount of waste, I already mentioned.
Yeah.
So that's also important.
Okay, so there's a lot of criteria you have to look at. And that's something you test all over the world, but it probably comes back in cycles, as all the growers grow in cycles as well. So every cycle you check again. I mean, in Holland, obviously, we've got the seasons.
Yeah.
So do you see differences in varieties, how they perform, for example, in summer and in winter time?
Yes. There are some varieties which are very suitable only for the winter.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, there are also varieties which are quite suitable for the summer production. But we focus on year-round production.
Okay, that's the main goal to have a
The main goal is that we should produce it, or we can produce it year-round, wherever it is grown.
Okay, I mean that's great. I mean, and they are grown all over the world as well, chrysanthemums. So
we're selling in about 40 countries, I think.
Yeah.
Well, chrysanthemums are grown almost everywhere.
Yeah, I mean it's a specific flower as well, because you just can't plant them and they will flower by themselves. They will eventually when it's autumn time.
Yeah.
But to get it flowering a chrysanthemum year round in the period you want, it takes quite some preparation or some planning as well.
Yes, it takes some preparation and planning with blackout screens or lightning. You can help them to flower earlier or later. So we have some way to help them flower.
To trick the chrysanthemum into the period they normally flower.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really cool, the technology. And I mean, to be honest, sometimes I say, if you are a chrysanthemum grower, you need to be a bit crazy, because you can't skip a day in your greenhouse. One mistake with the lights or one mistake with the shading, and you can end up with a problem. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Growing chrysanthemums is not that easy. For instance, it's quite a short cycle.
Yeah.
So if you make a mistake, then you have no time to recover.
Yeah.
So it's not that easy. And also with chrysanthemum, the irrigation,
yeah,
the use of water is quite specific. So that is also one thing you pay attention to.
Okay.
You have to pay attention to.
Yeah. So if you want to start as a grower, it's better to start with another crop to learn and to get the green fingers, as they call it, before you risk it with chrysanthemums.
Oh, on the other hand, we always can support you with technical advice. Our salesmen do that throughout the world. So,
yeah. I mean, it's. I think the salesmen, especially the ones I've seen in Holland and visiting the customers, I think 99% is advising and helping out, and maybe 1% is selling.
Yeah. To be honest, some of them are not that good of salesmen, but they are very good in giving technical advice. And by doing that, they are selling.
Yeah, I think you all need, I mean, it's in the end, it's also your variety. Your name is on it. So you want to have it in a high quality standard as well.
Yeah, we want to have reliable products for our customers and to get satisfactory,
yeah,
from our customers and consumers.
Yeah, I mean, in the end, you just want people to ask for your variety, and some of, yeah, the varieties of Deliflor, they're already there for I don't know how many years. I mean, I remember when I worked for Deliflor, we were celebrating the 1 billion white anesthesia rooted.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, unbelievable. And probably with Baltica, you're going the same direction already.
Yeah, I didn't count it, but I guess we are close to the 1 billion.
Soon we have a party again.
Invitation coming up.
Yeah. I mean, the breeding process is getting more professional as well. While, I mean, yeah, it used to be like, okay, this is Papa, this is Mama, I like the white one, I like the pink one, let's put them together and hopefully we get a beautiful one out of it. But you've got a beautiful laboratory now with Deliflor as well.
Yeah.
And then that also plays a role in testing and breeding, or yeah, crossbreeding as well.
Yeah, it enables us, the new breeding techniques enables us to speed up the process. That's one thing.
Okay.
And to clearly identify tolerances, resistance, and so on.
Okay.
So it helps us to develop the resistance,
yeah,
we want in order to have a more sustainable varieties.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, it speeds up the process. But it comes along with, well, quite some input in money,
yeah,
in developing new techniques, knowledge. But we're doing okay.
Yeah, but it's really cool that you as a breeder already, you can influence the whole chain already from the beginning with the sustainability part by getting varieties with only, or that has almost 100% A grade, so there's not a lot of small branches that has a resistance against some diseases or insects. So there's less use of pesticides.
Yep.
Although I think a lot of growers are 100% biological or almost there in Holland, yep, already. So
yep,
they are already on a very high level.
Yeah. Also in Africa, we call our production location there green.
Yeah.
Which means that we not able to ban the chemical pesticides fully,
yeah,
but we are, well, doing quite a good job by using beneficials, natural beneficials, in,
yeah,
order to protect our crops. And well, it takes maybe some year, a few years, and then we are fully capable of using of or having crop protection only by using beneficials.
Wow, that's
so not only in Holland.
Yeah, I mean that's really cool. I mean that's something. While talking about Africa again, so one step from breeding to making young plants in Africa, they are sent to Holland.
Yeah.
In boxes in small.
Yeah, or directly to our customers abroad, but
okay.
Most of them are going to Holland. Yes.
Yeah. So also skipping extra transport, you're sending also from Africa directly to
Japan or whatever. Yeah.
Okay. So it keeps them fresh. Plus you don't fly two times with the team. Okay.
Yeah.
That's really cool. Here you can't see it because you're on the phone, but I've got a picture here of a box of cuttings. They are in small packages, and they're about 50, I think, 50 cuttings in one package.
Yeah.
If correct. I'm right.
Yeah.
Okay. When getting them into Holland, I mean, they are checked in Africa, I think 100 times. In Holland, you check them again. Length and all those things.
Yes, because in Holland, we are most of the cuttings we sell in Holland are going to be rooted by ourselves in two specific rooting stations.
Yeah.
And the quality standard which is required by our customers here, specifically in Holland, is quite high.
Okay.
So we got specialized and well equipped rooting stations.
Yeah.
Two here in Holland, which enables us to stand up to that quality which is demanded.
Yeah.
And so but we also have to check and control in several stages here in Holland and in Africa all kinds of things which can influence the quality. So yeah, we do several checks in the process.
Yeah. And while 15 years ago you had a lot of women working and putting all the cuttings in the trays.
Yeah.
Some of them are still there, but you've got some robots as well doing that job now.
Yeah. Yeah. Since 10 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
Robots are replacing the people who are sticking the cuttings in the peat pot.
Yeah.
Where we root them in. About 90, we have got 36 robots, and we stick about 90% of what we have to root.
Yeah.
Has been sticked by the robots.
Okay. And it's especially now when labor is a problem. I mean, there was somebody really smart foreseeing that labor could be a problem in the future, and having those robots in, I mean, that's a great thing.
Yeah.
And after the robot puts them in the peat pots, you will root them.
Yeah.
And that's the most funny thing, I think, when showing people around the deli floor, you have the chance to go to deli floor, they've got their own train.
Come and see it.
Yeah, there really is a train that's bringing the cuttings into the greenhouse, and when they're fully grown, when they have their roots, so they can go to the customers, the growers, there's a train picking up all those crates. And
yeah.
it's a lot of crates that it's picking up in one go. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Yeah. We try to, in order to be efficient in what we do,
yeah,
mechanization, automation, but also using artificial intelligence nowadays. All the standard work,
yeah,
we try to let it be done by machines.
Okay.
And more we are going to use technique,
yeah,
to do the work, because for all the labor which is very where there's a lot of repeats, and also because of the volumes, because we are rooting, that's the main problem, we are rooting an awful lot of cuttings, and it takes a lot of people to do the work.
Yeah.
If we don't mechanize, if we don't automize, then there will be a lot of labor necessary.
I mean, I can imagine. I mean, more or less on an average week, how many cuttings are you are they rooted every week at the two locations?
14 million.
14 million.
Yeah.
Wow. And taking in account that there's more or less 100 cuttings in one tray, that means 1.4 million trays a week.
Yep.
Okay. That's a lot.
Sorry, 140,000.
Oh, yeah, sorry, 140, yeah. But still, yeah. A lot.
Yeah, still a lot.
Oh, it's.
If you, 30 years ago, I was picking them up by hand.
Yeah.
All of them. Well, not all of them, but because then at that time, I was working there and there was no machine doing it. And if you think of it, if you have to pick up 130 crates each week by hand.
Nice. No, it's not possible anymore. I mean, the amount of labor and the amount of space and everything that you do need. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, Kirsten van Dijk is also saying, wow. I mean, the amount of we are talking about, the millions and how many cuttings, unbelievable. Yeah. Johan Heemskerk is also saying, sticking cuttings by humans can cause repetitive strain on the wrists. Then you need robots.
Yeah.
That's also true. Although people also like, I mean, we talked about people being at the Daily Floor for a long time.
Yeah.
And when I started working at Daily Floor, they showed me the whole company and I needed, and I also wanted to see every part of the job within the company. And I was there as well, I think half a day putting the cuttings in there. And I thought, okay, I don't want to do this for a week. This is difficult. But it turns out, there are women working at Daily Floor who are doing it over 20, 30 years already.
25 years. Recently, one of them was 25 years doing that same job and still enjoying it.
Unbelievable. I mean, it's, yeah. I mean, it must be, or I know it's a great company, but just for people to know, I mean, if you do a repetitive job every day, but still like it and with a big smile go to your work every day.
Yeah.
I mean, that's fantastic.
We try to make them as comfortable as possible, and also do some besides the normal work we have to do. We also try to do have some extra activities.
Yeah.
To enjoy together and so on, and
I think it's not the building that makes a company. It's the people that make the company.
It's the people, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And we even got Daily Floor Colombia in. Our buddy Juan David is in, looking good. Juan David, you're looking good as well. Although I'm not really sure it's you on the avatar. I mean, Juan David is in Daily Floor Colombia. Actually, next week, they got a show going on there. They got he's already saying it. They got the Deli Show, Deliwood, coming up next week. Come see us in Colombia for Deli Show. I think Deli Floor in Holland, but also Colombia is already quite famous for their shows, for their trials. I have some pictures. It's not only in the greenhouse, but the whole decoration inside to get the guests in is really beautifully done. And why? I mean, you can just show the varieties, but why do you make, I mean, I'm showing a picture with a beautiful old-timer American car there. Why go through all that effort? Can you hear me, Peter?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Why?
I thought you asked a question to Juan David.
Oh, now, why do you go through all the effort of making all the decorations and all those things? I mean, it's in the end, it's about the flowers.
Yes, of course, it's about the flowers. But, we try to make a little bit of a show and also to make it fancy, comfortable. We try to give something extra.
Yeah. And I'm just showing some of the pictures of the shows that have been going on. For the people, just stay tuned, because I got a sneak preview from the Daily Show in Colombia as well, so you can already see some of those beautiful varieties there. Kirsten Van Dijk has a good one actually as well. She's saying Pinterest and Insta has changed the marketing forever. It's also one of the next topics we're gonna touch, Kirsten. First, I want to stay with the whole shows you are doing with all the varieties at the same time flowering to get people in. I mean, how many flowers do you have, or how many different varieties do you have flowering during the trials?
Well, normally about in between 200 and 400 in a trial.
Wow.
In chrysanthemums, you have all kind of shapes, all kind of colors. So there's a lot to show.
Yeah.
And next to that, you've got three groups, the sprays, the santinis, and the disbuds. So again, there's a lot to show.
Yeah.
But there's also different demands, and we're always looking together with our partners in the supply chain to new product market combinations with varieties.
Yeah. I mean, there are so many new varieties. While I'm showing a small video where we go into the greenhouse and we can see all those varieties flowering at the same time, and we see it's all chrysanthemums. But that isn't as easy as it looks, as every flower has its own characteristics. So get them to flower all at the same time. That's like being at the Olympics, I think.
That's a big compliment I have to give them every time that we have got a commercial trial. Well, normally there are so many different varieties, they cannot flower together in one time.
Yeah.
But they succeed every time. I don't know how they manage sometimes, but they succeed.
Yeah, it's maybe a bit technical, but there's called a reaction time. So from starting from the short day period, which turns the chrysanthemum into making flowers.
There's an echo again.
Okay, then we do the magic trick again. And we're back again without the echo, hopefully.
Yep. Magic trick works.
Yeah, I mean, it always works. getting back to the story, so the reaction time, every chrysanthemum grows in a bit of a different way. So that's why it's so difficult. And that's why in Holland, you see a lot of growers not growing 20 or 50 varieties in one greenhouse. And that's why it's so special to get 300 varieties flowering at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah, each variety has its own response time, which means that from starting of the bud initiation till flowering time will take a certain amount of days.
Yeah.
And for each variety, it's more or less set, the amount of days. So one variety can flower at 45 days, and the next one can flower at 55 days.
Yeah.
So there can be quite some difference. For instance, santinis, that we've got santinis flowering already at 35 days.
Wow.
While some disbuds will flower only at 60 days. So yeah. There's a lot of difference.
Yeah. To make the most out of the space you have in your greenhouse, you need to have the varieties that are more or less on the same response time then.
Yeah. We group them in the trials at response time, and we put little screens between the different varieties.
Yeah.
In order to get them flowering all at the same time.
Yeah, I mean it's unbelievable. And for the people watching, week 24, when we don't have some strange viruses flying around anymore. that's the big week for international visitors to go to Delhi Flor and see the beauty of the chrysanthemums. And I invited also people that weren't really involved in chrysanthemums. And when we opened the doors of the greenhouse, the first reaction was, I thought you were only doing chrysanthemums, but I see so many shapes, so many colors. How is it possible that it's all chrysanthemum? And I mean,
yeah. also consumers sometimes react. 2 weeks ago, I offered all my neighbors a bunch of really nice chrysanthemums, bouquets,
yeah,
made out of several types of chrysanthemums. And well, I think from the 8 people, neighbors I gave the bouquets, 3 of them reacted, "Are that chrysanthemums? Are yeah. you sure? Because yeah. and where can we buy that? Because we don't know them. We have never seen it."
And it's unbelievable because you live in an area where there's a lot of production of flowers as well. So people yeah. should know about their flowers.
Yeah, they should know. But well, to be honest, not every variety we produce or we develop is being sold on the local market.
Yeah, ah, that's true. I mean, it's. I mean, most of the varieties go for export. I mean,
yeah.
Holland yeah. is just a small country in the end.
Yeah. yeah.
So beautiful those trials. In January you have trials as well, which is more focused on the
local
market.
Breed.
Yeah, for Dutch market.
Dutch customers. Yeah.
Yeah, and one fun thing I think you are organizing there as well is the award Grower Got Talent.
Yeah, what we do is we ask our customers to send in a bunch of flowers which they produce themselves, and we've got a jury in which also some growers participate and some breeders and some wholesalers.
Yeah.
They're going to judge the bunches which are were offered by our customers. And I think last year we had about 130 faces of bunches of chrysanthemums.
Yeah.
And well, we let them be judged, and we give for the first, second, and third prize, we give a nice prize.
Okay. But that's really cool. And it's also cool, I think, because that 130 vases, I don't know exactly, but there are more growers, for example, for Baltica. To see them next to each other as well, and to see the differences probably as well between the growers is really interesting.
Sorry, John, you're having an echo again. And in the meanwhile, I'll answer your question.
Okay.
Yeah, for them it's very nice to. There's always a nice competition in between the growers.
Yeah,
they want to be the best Baltica grower or the best Daliana grower.
Yeah.
So there's always quite some level of competition in between them.
Yeah, I mean it's cool, and also to see them all together and then. It's already really nice to see them all there and standing next to each other. It makes it already special.
Yeah, yeah. That's a nice presentation as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Coming to all the, after testing all the varieties, it's time to introduce it when it's good. You've got a whole marketing team as well. Putting, it's a bit Dutch, but putting the variety into the market.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why do you?
Yeah, before introduction, we do some trials together with some of our supply chain partners.
Yeah.
And we're trying to get some feedback and information on some characteristics, like, for instance, transportation ability, phase life after transportation, but also what. Do people like the flower? Because in the end, we can develop very good varieties with very high specifications, technical specifications, but somebody has to buy it and has to love it.
And that's most of the time the difficult part.
Yeah. So that's also what we, before introduction, we do some investigation. And well, is it maybe interesting for wholesalers who are selling to Russia? Or wholesalers who are selling to Scandinavia or to England. And sometimes varieties can be very popular in one country, in Scandinavia, but not popular at all in other countries.
Yeah. I mean, it's really cool that that Daily Floor is traveling the whole world to get to see the trends in chrysanthemums and see how things are working. I mean, as we speak, they're in Eastern Europe checking out the market over there before the 1st of September. I know that from Colombia, they're traveling a lot to the US, also see what's happening in the market. So I think it's really cool to, I mean, it takes 5 years, of course, to react. But still, if you see that the early adopters are going more towards blooms or the single heads, then you can react as a breeder as well.
Yeah. Yeah, we try to keep in touch with the trends there are worldwide. But we try to promote the varieties in the supply chain.
Yeah.
To give support, both technical as commercial support and in marketing. Developing marketing concepts. So, yeah.
I think one of the great new things that you have developed are the 360 videos of the varieties.
Yeah.
Especially for florists out there, while I'm showing one of them, it's Radost. You can see the stem from every angle. So you exactly know what you can expect from that stem, because just a single picture doesn't always do right to how the flower looks.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah. And that, I think I've got it somewhere here so I can show it. Let me see. It's the website delishow.nl. If you go there, you can see all the varieties of Daily Floor in 3D. So if you want to make an arrangement and you don't know which flower to get, just go to delishow.nl and you can find the right variety for you. That works. Also, talking about promotion, Peter, the 9th of September for the chrysanthemum is a special day.
Yes.
Already indeed. For ages, actually, already.
Yeah, for many ages, yeah.
So, and last year during the COVID period, we sat together, both Daily Floor and Flower Circus, thinking, okay, we need to do something for the people, not traveling or not possible to travel. And already in Japan they are celebrating Chrysanthemum Day the 9th of September for ages. That's one of the big five holidays they have in Japan. And yeah, we decided to make it an international Chrysanthemum Day. Last year we celebrated with an online show, and this year again. I mean, how cool is that?
I mean, it's good to honor the chrysanthemums, which has been in, for instance, in Japan, it's part of the, it's inside the seal of the Japanese empire.
Yeah.
And it has been in Japan. It has been very important, the chrysanthemum, and we wanted to appeal to it.
Yeah.
Together with Flower Circus, last year you gave a magnificent show with the Top Arranger.
Yeah.
And in order to help to promote chrysanthemums, but also to help florists.
Yeah.
With new ideas, new concepts. So yeah.
Yeah. And this year we got a great designer again. We got a Belgian designer, or Belgium says French designer, Max Hurto. He's number 3 of Belgium last year. So
okay.
Really great designer, very talented. He already made some beautiful arrangements before with Daily Floor chrysanthemums. So for the people, the 9th of September, 3 p.m. Central European time, you can already register on flowercircus.nl or on our Facebook site. So stay tuned for that. If you can't wait, next Friday we also have an online show, and we will work, of course, with some beautiful chrysanthemums from Daily Floor. Because if you want to use chrysanthemums in all colors, styles, and everything, we're going to show some new ones as well this or next Friday. So make sure you tune in.
And PM and be inspired.
And be inspired. And if you want to see more, David Marin is saying as well, we're going to have a virtual Delhi show in Colombia delishowlatinamerica.com. So, I mean, if you love chrysanthemums, you're in the right spot. If you're thinking chrysanthemums, you're in the right spot as well, because you will fall in love with the chrysanthemums after seeing all those things, for sure. And like I already, Kirsten van Dijk is saying, maximizing the chrysanthemums. I mean, that's already a really good one. Oh, it's, but yeah, like I said, everything you do to with the chrysanthemum, from starting with the breeding to really helping the growers grow it, helping the wholesalers sell it, even helping the florists selling by showing it via our flower circus shows, but also doing shows yourself, product presentations. I know you've got a great tool for people who have an open day, so you can send chrysanthemums there as well to decorate an open day. I mean, yeah, just contact Deliflor for the possibilities, because I think they're endless. And like I said before, we're going to have a sneak preview from Colombia. Next week, it's Chrysanthemum or Deliwood, they call it. First, we'll show the trailer, because yeah, Deliwood needs a trailer. More than 250 chrysanthemum varieties in the same greenhouse from August 30th to September 3rd. So make sure you'll check their virtual tour as well. And you'll see here is some of the images which are shot yesterday in the greenhouse. You can already see how it's almost flowering, so getting ready for next week. I can even hear the birds singing. And I can even see the Oscars. So I think some of the prize-winning chrysanthemums will be there as well. I mean, how fantastic is that? And I think it looks a little bit, Peter, like there's a competition between Holland and Colombia, who has the nicest show, or is making the nicest presentation every year. And it's already at a very high level. So. Curious what you come up with next time.
Oh, come and see.
Yeah, oh, for sure I will. And hopefully we can go live in the greenhouse as well, then, to show people more of those beautiful varieties.
You're all invited.
Yeah, I mean, once all of this is over and we can travel again, I think we should have a big chrysanthemum party live. I know that there's chrysanthemum tea for the people who don't drink alcohol. There's chrysanthemum beer for the people who like alcohol. Actually, I know
you can even eat it, but not all of them.
No, and just make sure you buy the right ones.
Yes.
And I even know that, but maybe that's a little bit inside secret, that one of the breeders at Deliflor is making his own liquor with chrysanthemums as well.
Oh, couldn't tell you that.
No? Well, I know, but maybe it's different interest, maybe. Juan David is saying we cannot give any more spoilers, just so just check in at Deliflor show latinamerica.com. Kirsten van Dijk is saying I tried the chrysanthemum beer, it's good. So I mean, it's maybe you get even more creative if you drink the chrysanthemum beer and then work with chrysanthemums.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Send in some examples.
Yeah, Kirsten, you heard it. Send some examples to Deliflor so we can see what's going on. Well, Juan David is quickly sending some pictures as well. But Juan David is actually showing the Magnum beer. Let me quickly get it into the stream as well. It's the nice thing of technique. Because with the introduction, Deliflor tends to do some special things. I mean, in Holland, I remember that one picture I've got ready already with VIP, one of the varieties. That was champagne handed out to some of the buyers. And I don't know what it is with people who work with chrysanthemums and alcohol.
It's a coincidence.
Yeah, it's a coincidence that Baltica is named after a Russian beer and that Limoncello is also named after some kind of liquor. But here it is, the Magnum beer. So that's what they did in Colombia. Also really, really cool, and to make it extra special to introduce a new variety. So, Peter, to one final question. Is there something special coming up, or what you can already share us? Maybe a new shape, a new color, or maybe a resistance against some kind of disease? Or what are your goals what you as a real chrysanthemum man? I mean, you're not born between the chrysanthemums, but almost like that. It feels almost like that, working so long with chrysanthemums. What's your personal goal? Let's put it that way. What would be the perfect chrysanthemum for you to introduce?
Oh, my personal goal. Oh, some of my colleagues know what my personal goal is with chrysanthemums, but it's more in the production process.
Okay.
And again, alcohol comes in.
I don't know why.
Growing chrysanthemum, you're dealing with a natural product.
Yeah.
And although you're selling a natural product, you want it to be perfect. But in order to get it perfect, you need to have standardized your processes completely.
Yeah.
And I always refer to, I've been buying a crate of beer for, let's say, 30 years already.
Yeah.
Almost every time the same brand. And for 30 years, the taste, the color, the TAT, the how do you call it?
The due date.
Due date. It has been always the same, and there was never a problem. Most probably they have standardized their processes so well, and although it is a natural product as well.
Yeah. Here, yeah.
Because the same as a chrysanthemum, it's a natural product. So there are always difficulties to expect with natural products, because you cannot manage everything. But my goal is to have that crate of beer in our chrysanthemums that we can manage our processes so well that if the quality is guaranteed always.
Yeah, that's a great goal to work to. I mean, also just
but,
to...
But sorry, John, but that is for production of cuttings and so on. But in flowers, I want them. Our main goal is sustainability, what I already mentioned.
Yeah.
And we're still selling varieties which are susceptible for instance, Fusarium, which is a soil-borne disease, but it's not necessary. But people still demand that variety.
Yeah.
But we can abandon it or banish it completely.
Yeah.
Because we are able to get our resistance in all our varieties by the new breeding techniques. That's just an example, but maybe one time we can develop chrysanthemums which are not susceptible for any diseases anymore.
I mean, that would be great, of course. It benefits the whole chain, the whole world. Let's put it that way. I mean, don't forget that. I mean, and also when they can be grown at a colder temperature, if you don't need...
You don't have to have a high energy input.
Yeah.
Another thing is that we want to, because in Holland we are rooting, but I already told you, we're rooting our chrysanthemums in a peat pot. And the production of peat, the winning of peat, comes along a lot of CO2 emission. And in our goals to sustainability, we want to reduce the amount of peat.
Okay.
We already reduce it with about 20%, but we want to reduce it a lot more in order to, well, to meet our goals for sustainability.
I mean those goals, I mean, it's really cool working on that and making steps along the way as well. And I think all the processes will help you as well, of course, in the breeding. You know where to find when a variety can handle a disease or not, or is, and all those things step by step. It isn't big steps, of course, but every step will make all those small steps will make a huge difference in the end.
And it will take time, but we will succeed.
Yeah,
I'm convinced.
And don't forget a small step doing, 14 million cuttings a week is a big step already.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's really cool, because we didn't mention it, but we mentioned you have two production or rooting facilities in Holland.
Yeah.
But they're both located in the center of the two areas in Holland.
Areas. Yeah.
The production area. So there's almost no trucks driving from one production area to the other.
Now, although Holland is small, but transporting 140,000 crates with a lorry, that's got a lot of impact. So we already many years ago developed set two production locations for rooting in the two biggest production areas we have in Holland.
Yeah.
So in order to minimize the amount of lorry kilometers.
Okay, I mean that's wonderful how you think about those things.
Yeah.
Great. Great. Thank you very much. Is there something I forgot? If there's something what you want to add?
Oh, I just want to add how proud I am for chrysanthemums in generally, because chrysanthemums are coming in many shapes, in many colors. They've got a very strong vase life. They're very good to transport. It brings beauty to everyone's life, I think.
Yeah.
And that's something, well, which we cannot tell enough.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a versatile flower with all the shapes, all the colors. I mean, you cannot not love chrysanthemums, because there's always one that fits your needs in color, shape, and all those things. So, I mean, you're totally right. And Johan is saying, thanks, Peter, and Circus Director John. Johan, thank you. Thank you for watching. And everybody else, also, thank you for watching. If you like the show, please put a thumb up. If you want to see more Flower Circus Talks, just check out our YouTube page, where there are more Flower Circus Talks. Actually, 95 more Flower Circus Talks. So if you have nothing to do this weekend, you can do that. Thanks again. Peter, thank you again. Hope to see you next week on the Flower Circus show.
John, thanks for having me.
Yeah.
And thanks for everyone for watching. And hope you enjoy your flowers.
Yeah, and let's drink a beer next time. I mean, chrysanthemums and beer. I mean, that's something. I know your brand, so I will bring a crate.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you for watching, everybody. Bye bye.
Bye bye.